Welcome back to my channel, ladies and gentlemen of YouTube, or if you're new around here, welcome. Today, we're going to be going over Grand Chase. So what is Grand Chase? Grand Chase is a free-to-play MMORPG on Steam that has a large and growing catalog of content. It's a game that can also serve your action RPG fix if you're looking for something short-term or a simple story to experience with fantastic core gameplay. The game has a plethora of characters to play as, 21 to be exact, all with unique playstyles. Characters have anywhere from 1 to 4 classes, all of which play almost as if they were entirely different characters, in a good way. This game will have you fighting your way through dungeons, alone or with friends, gathering loads of loot, pets, and crafting tools along the way. The combat is very unique and is entirely playable using only the keyboard, no mouse required. You will find yourself jumping, running, fighting, comboing, chaining abilities, and dodging your way through fast-paced dungeons and intense boss battles as you weave your way through the main story, until you reach the endgame, where the game only gets more exciting. But without further ado, let's get into the purpose of this video, an introduction to and a beginner's guide for Grand Chase Classic. The very first thing Grand Chase will ask you to do is to pick your server. Any server will do. I usually select whichever server has the most players online. That in my case would be Asia 1. You can also, of course, select whichever server is most likely to you if you have low internet bandwidth or don't have a fast internet connection. I can tell which server is the busiest because of the fact that this one is in red and it says busy. The other way to check is fair, which is blue, is the lowest. Then there's then there will be green, and then there will be yellow, and then the highest busyness is busy, which will show up in red. Once you see that, or whichever server you want to click on, you just go ahead and hit connect to server. Connected your server, Grand Chase will ask you to create a username. Fill in here with whatever you personally feel fits you the best. For me, I'm just going to go with something simple. Itching Wang. Apparently TW is unsafe, so we're going to go with Itching Wang, and then we'll just put a random number in here, Itching Wang 5. It's going to tell you you have no character, and that you want to select an empty slot in order to choose your character. There are plenty of characters to choose from in Grand Chase, so there'll certainly be at least one fitting your playstyle. Clicking on each character gives you a mini trailer revealing what they do as well as their difficulty for new players. You can see that right here, and you can see their name here, and you can see their little video here. The two newest characters released are Decany and AI, which are both very fun to play. But for simplicity's sake, we're going to go ahead and pick Elisis. She is very beginner-friendly, and one of the most simple characters to play. Don't worry, though, you can eventually have all characters in the game, and even for free. Once we're alright with our character, we just need to confirm our selection. You receive a pass and going ahead and doing this. This will immediately load you into a mission by the Nightmaster. You can press the Z key to skip, and this will kind of go to the next piece of dialogue, or you can press X to close, which will skip all dialogue. There is only one piece of dialogue there at the beginning, so skipping it will kind of send you right through the whole thing. This game is unique in the fact that when you're in missions, you don't actually need your mouse for any input at all, even though you actually have access to it, so you can hover over different things that show up on your screen. Your movement is entirely tied to your movement key, or the arrow key. So right will obviously take you right, left takes you left, up is your jump key, and down is how you fall through objects once you've landed on top of them. You can also, when you're playing a character that is sprint, you can double tap in either direction, that will increase your sprinting. You can also sprint midair. Other characters have dashes or teleports, but Elisis is a very good and beginner-friendly character in the sense that she actually has a sprint, which just keeps it simple for us now and gives us high mobility. Again, kind of dialogue pops up. You can go ahead and skip it, or you can close it altogether. I'm going to kind of focus mostly on skipping dialogue or closing it completely, just to kind of prevent any spoilers in case you want to play or experience this game for yourself, as it is a phenomenal game. It being an MMO or action RPG, I feel like a lot of people aren't playing this game exclusively for its story, especially being an online game, since kind of with MMOs, story falls in the background. But we're going to kind of go ahead and skip it in case anybody does truly care about it. You will notice that I'm using special abilities or different combos other than just normal combat, which is just kind of tapping the Z key. As you tap the Z key, it kind of sends you through a basic chain of attacks. but you can actually add inputs from the up key, down key, left key, right key, or even other keys, and that will kind of give you different effects. Now, whenever you complete a mission, you get your clear time, your best clear time, your damage rank, your best damage rank, as well as your EXP earn, and your GP, which is the non-premium in-game currency. Afterwards, you typically get a chest choice, but because that was a tutorial, it kind of goes a little bit different. But after you finish, you get your reward screen, which is kind of the different things you've picked up and earned throughout the mission. We got one crystal, one topaz dust, and Roman shoes. After playing your first mission, you might have actually gotten entirely different stuff from me. The only thing that you'll really have gotten consistently with me is maybe the crystal, but you could have gotten an entirely different piece of gear. Maybe not even topaz dust, you could have got ruby dust or whatever. The rewards are kind of randomly generated as you're playing your mission. But you will notice a lot of stuff on your screen. Most of this I would not at all worry about, but if you're kind of somebody who likes looking into the menus, like me, you can go ahead and do that. You'll find a bunch of interesting stuff in here. But the game does have a really good soundtrack as well, if you want to listen to that. But the main things to look for right now is anything with a red dot. So our missions have a red dot, which means 9 times out of 10 that we have a mission completed. You always want to turn in your missions as you complete them, because they're going to give you all sorts of different rewards, as well as XP and GP. We see another red dot here in our repeat mission. This is our daily login. These are another bunch of quests, but we're not going to worry about those right now. And then you'll now see you got something in your inventory, most likely. So anything with a green arrow in the top left corner of it means that it actually increases your stats if you equip it, or at the very least it increases your main stat, which is your total attack stat, which is highly important because that kind of is relying on your special attack, your crit chance, your critical attack damage, attack, and vitality, just the main important stuff. So anytime you see this green arrow, I wouldn't stress about it, just always equip it. You don't really have to look at like, oh hey, let me look at the effects. Now, if it has that green arrow, 99.99% time it's better, unless you're going for a specific look, because every piece of armor equipment that you equip in this game actually changes your character's look, which you will notice soon as I unlock new gear. If we go back to the map, we'll notice all sorts of different things, like we have objects here, like this one here. This one shows a queue, which means typically that you have a quest there. If you have an exclamation point, that means if you go there, you unlock new quests for it, and then we have the queue again. Anything in color along this path means that you have it unlocked, and if it's a grayed out, it means you don't have it unlocked. The way that you unlock them is you do the dungeon before it. So if you do Trial Forest, you unlock Trial Tower, you unlock Outer Wall Certain, Carrie Beach, Orc Temple, Gorgos Dungeon, so on and so forth. You'll kind of see how it continues later on. Now, when you click on any of these icons, you have a few different options. So you can see different rooms that show up here, which are different people that might be playing the dungeon, or you can click see all rooms, and this is all the rooms that are game in progress for that specific dungeon. Now, a lot of people are closer to the end game in this game, and there are plenty of different servers. So you can transfer servers to find other people, or however you wish to do it. But we're going to go ahead and click here. You can click quick join, and that will automatically put you in any room that's waiting. It's already created, or you can click create room. We're going to go ahead and click create room. You can also customize your room name. We'll kind of just demonstrate that there by making custom room. You can add a password. If you add a password, random players are not able to join your lobby, but it does make it easier to have your friends join, because you can set a custom room name and you can set a password, and they could be the only ones to access your lobby. Now, whenever you're in a lobby and everybody's readied up, which if they're not the host, a ready up button right here will show up. Or if you're not the host, you'll get a ready up button here instead of the start one. But once everybody's ready up, you can hit start. You'll also notice your missions here. Experience Trial Tower and use our special Mega Slash, which the game tells us is equipped. For more information on that, you can click on your skill tree or you press the letter key K. Now your abilities show up on the special ability tab. And if we hover over these give us information on them. This is our Mega Slash level 1, which you can see is also right here. Loading can be really quick if you have a decent PC. Ready? Again, skipping all dialogue. Ellis is an MP character. What that ends up meaning is that our character generates mana over time, which is what AP characters do. AP characters just tend to do it at a faster rate, but MP characters have the advantage of whenever they land an attack on an opponent, they also generate MP. MP is this blue bar here. for AP characters, it's purple. Now, you'll notice that the bars actually have little lines on them. I kind of used up my mana there, so which makes it kind of hard to demonstrate. But I'll kind of show you here once I kill these guys. When you look at the top left, you'll kind of notice that these little this big, large MP bar is actually split into different chunks. And as it hits different chunks, different abilities highlight. So, on MP characters, the typical way that it goes is you'll have three abilities. A, S, and then D. And the button that you need to press to activate them shows up as you have the mana for them. Your A is always going to take one bar of mana. Your S is always going to take two bars of mana. And your D is always going to take all three bars. Typically, the more bars it takes up, the stronger it is. And I'll demonstrate this here. So if we use our A, it takes one. And we continue to generate more. If we use our S, it uses up two bars of mana. For this, it could be slightly different for AP characters, but again, we're going to continue to focus on MP characters because that's what Elisys is, and she's a very beginner-friendly character. Later on, I do intend to do a guide video of sorts for the top 5 best beginner characters, or best characters for beginners. But for now, we're just kind of going to continue showing what I believe is important for beginners. So if we kind of add the up key into our combos on Elisys, we can actually knock him into the air depending on his stance. Whenever an enemy starts to glow red or has a red highlighter out them, that does mean that they're going to go into an attack here very soon. The timing can always be different depending on the characters or enemy that you're fighting. You are no match for me. So this time it does actually show us with the chest and stuff. You can either click on the chest that you want, or you can type in the number itself. It's very random what loot you get into it. I always just, for the past however long I play this game, always do 3. Again, whenever you finish a mission, you go down to your mission tab here. Just okay everything. That'll kind of finish out these quests. And now we have this quest. So now that we don't have any more quests at Trial Tower and we're the host, we can click on the another dungeon key, and we can click on Outer Wall of Cerdan. That's the next one. And now we see we have quests again. The other way that we can do this is if you leave a lobby, if you're not host and not moving to the next one or wherever it is, you can kind of just exit, go to your level, and then we're gonna set up our own room again. We see that our inventory is glowing red or has a red dot. We see we have not more gear with the green box around it, so we can go ahead and equip that by right clicking on it again. The main concept of this game, at least for now, is kind of going from dungeon to dungeon to dungeon and unlocking more rewards, missing and leveling up. There are a lot of different things for you to worry about in this game and a lot of different concepts and cool stuff that you can unlock in this game, but the game kind of right now is just slowly taking you through trial, and this is your first technical real dungeon, as these are both tutorial or shorthand trial areas. So I'm going to go ahead and do a couple dungeons, and as I run into more information that I feel fit for you guys, I'm going to make some more video clips for you. Upon reaching your 50th monster kill within plus or minus 2 levels of your level range, you'll notice you've gotten a quick save level 1 reward. This is a special reward, and you interact with that differently than typical rewards. So we're going to go ahead and accept these quests we have completed. We'll go down here into our inventory, and on the etc. tab, which is where you kind of hold all your event stuff or crafting materials, etc., you'll also notice this quest. This quest is unique in the sense that you actually have to go into your inventory and okay it here to equip it. This will unlock the ability for you to be able to actually dodge while you're inside of a mission by pressing the Alt key and then tapping to the left or to the right, depending on if you want to dodge through the enemy onto your left or onto the right. Now, you also notice that you probably have some equipment by now that actually does change your appearance, like I had mentioned previously. Your appearance can kind of look kind of crude when you first begin playing, but as you level up, you unlock much cooler and much better gear. By now, you may have also gotten your first little button here in the collection tab. This will be in the title tab, and you'll kind of notice all these different ones. This one says gets, this is the one we're going to get, and we should also have that one. if you've made it past Carrier Beach. So you guys would have the same ones as us. So the way to check of how to unlock these is if you click on one that you don't have and you hit the condition. So for the Orc Temple one, it says if you clear it once, you get the Orc Temple one. So we go to a different example here, Claw Shrimp Slayer. If we clear the Clear Lake Aurora 17 times, that will get us that title. Now, with any of these titles, you actually have a small percentage chance of getting the title without actually clearing it that many times. So it might say 17 times, but you can get it on your first try, second try, third try, whatever. But if you don't have it by the time you get your 17th attempt to the dungeon, you will be guaranteed it then. One of the main things I'll mention is that you should also be looking out for red dots anywhere on any of these tabs as you play. Now, right now, it seems like there's a lot of them. But trust me, it's not as overwhelming as you think. Up here is your attendance reward. Once you've been logged in for 30 minutes on any day, you'll get your attendance rewards. 500 points, 100 of the in-game currency, 1 champion ticket, and 1 dungeon festival ticket. A lot of that will make more sense as we get further into this video. But for now, we're just going to leave it at that. Just claim your rewards. This next one is actually, again, once you've been logged in for 30 minutes in a day, you'll get these rewards. This is your 15-day trial period. So when you first start out or make a new account, this is your 15 days of rewards. If you make it all the way to your 14th day, you'll actually get 7 days of the GC premium effect, just to kind of celebrate that you've gotten that far. And that's, in my opinion, one of the biggest rewards on this entire thing. Next one is your event-specific ones. This icon here will always change, but it will always be there. This is, again, 30-minute login, but this is tied to the current event that's running. These rewards are all very good for both new game and end game players, so definitely look forward to that. These informations here will always be tied to the different event that's running at the moment as well. I'm not going to go into deep information for those, though, because the event that you are seeing as you play the game may actually be different. This bar at the little bottom middle is actually pretty cool too. It scrolls from the right to the left. It just kind of celebrates people that just got something to a plus 17, which, again, you guys will get to see further in the game. And then this one, this is as you level up. These are kind of your main rewards. They tell you exactly what to do, and this is what you get for them. I would kind of put this on the back burner for now, and as you play, you know, just kind of figure it out. But it's a very good way to get a lot of the in-game premium currency, because this VP currency you see here is actually very important. VP, very important. But I don't know what it actually stands for. Maybe VIP points. But you basically get about 1,000 to the dollar, and for every character you get to level 85 and complete all these quests, you actually get $3 worth of the currency per character just from this alone. Another way that you can get premium currency is actually going to the menu here, Hero Collection, and then you go over to the Achievement tab. This is where you can kind of look at what you need to do to get these different rewards here. Which, it's not a crazy amount of VP, but the biggest thing is each one of these Seal Breaker scrolls is actually worth 300 of the premium currency. And you do get a lot of these, which are used for the premium gacha sets for skins for your character, which is QWERTY sets. I can show you some of those right now. The QWERTY Seal Breaker down here. These are 3 of the sets that are currently running. Like, this one's up for 3 more days. This one's up for 17 more days. And this one's up for 10 more days. And this is just how they look on LSS. Every different character has a different look of how these sets look. They all come with a pet that matches the set, and they come with the armor set that matches the set. Now, you don't have to worry about the fear of missing out, because every single one of these sets rotates in and out. Every week, a new one cycles out, and a new one cycles in. So we pretty much always have a few different ones here for you to choose from. One of the things that I absolutely can't recommend enough for any new player starting out on Grand Chase is if you go down to the menu here, and you go to Hero Collection, you'll notice that there's all these different grayed out boxes. These are for all the classes and characters that you need to unlock within the game to get stat bonuses. Our current collection of effect is 20 attack and 20 vitality, and that's for having our LSS unlocked. But if we go to the menu again, and we go to select character, All the characters in this game can be claimed for free. Every character can actually be claimed immediately, other than Dio, and I'll show you that here. If you try to do it, it says you need at least one level 30 character to create a character. Reason why it says that is because Dio in original GC automatically starts out at level 30. So they don't want you kind of skipping through a chunk of the game if you're in a rush to get to the end game, and they want you to actually take your time to get there a little bit before they give you a level 30 character right off the bat. But I recommend, like I said, going through all of here and just unlocking every single one of these guys. It only takes you about a minute or two, depending on how fast and accurately you can move your mouse key and how fast your computer loads. But I'll show you in just a second once we get through the very last one here, which we're only a couple of characters away at this point. I will show you what you're going to get from this that makes it so important to do this, even if you don't intend to play any of them. Even though now it's going to be easier to play any of them because you have them all unlocked now. See, aren't some of these guys cute? Like AI, look at those eyes. But if we go back to Alysis, and we go down here, and we go to our hero collection again, we'll notice that there's a lot more highlighted now. And we'll see that we get all these different rewards. So if we look on the right, our total collection effect now is 160 attack, 90 defense, 100 vitality, 6% critical attack chance, 12.5% critical attack damage, 7.5% increased back attack damage. It's a lot of stuff. And your collection effect actually affects every single one of your characters. So I could go onto any other character of mine, like for example Rin, and you will see the exact same hero collection. Now this is important because that's going to make dungeon runs easier and quicker. And you're just going to be overall stronger, which will bring up your total attack stat here. Higher that is, stronger you are. Depending on how much attention you would pay, you may or may not have also noticed that whenever you're in a dungeon, it actually shows you your difficulty in items. Mostly just the items portion, since the difficulty option you only get in this game now is pretty much normal, outside of champion mode on some dungeons. These rewards show you what pet manual you're able to potentially obtain, which allows you to get your own specific pet, what armor set you might be able to actually obtain armor pieces from, as well as what weapon. You can actually obtain other items other than what shows up here, but the four items that always show up as your dungeon rewards in this section here are always the top tier items, so whatever the best stuff is that you can unlock from this area. You also have been unlocking points for your skill tree and different skills in your skill tree. I won't really go over this too much, as it's kind of up to personal taste as to which of these you feel is like the best, because you can actually get a different third bar here, for example. You can actually get a different second bar or first bar. You can unlock these different basic skill combos, and then all of your basic commands are here as well. But I may later do in-depth videos on each character's skill tree as I see fit, but at the moment in this beginner guide, I'm just kind of giving you a basic showcasing of it. By now, you may have actually run into the point that you've unlocked your first necklace or foot ornament. If you leave a lobby, you're actually able to upgrade these. All you have to do is you go to your inventory, you click on the little power-up button. I personally turn off the show effect button because it takes a while, but I'll demonstrate it once for you guys. It'll kind of do this purple glow, or either give you a success or failure, but I always turn it off. Basically, you kind of want to spend this. I would recommend getting your necklace up to a plus 5 if you can. The ankle bracelet I'm not too stressed about. But if you can get this up to a plus 5, you get the special effect, which is just going to make your character a little bit nicer in combat. Same with the foot ornament here, which we'll put some points into since we have a little left over. Let's see if we can actually get lucky enough to get both up to plus 5, even though we don't actually have a lot of gems. So it doesn't seem like we can, but gems are really easy to come by. Trust me, we are just now starting out, and these actually go up to plus 9 apiece. Although, personally, for most characters, I kind of take them up to a plus 6 and leave them be there until late game, and I'm kind of powering them up for the hardest stuff in the game. Once you've completed your first Forsaken Barrows run, you actually get your first temporary Cordy set. This doesn't last forever, as it only lasts 7 days exactly. But it is a nice little touch because it gives your character a slight boost on their power. A very, very slight one. but it does also make them look nice. And here's a very special moment in Grand Chase. Some characters have a second job, a third job, and a fourth job on top of their original first job, which was shown in the Hero Collection I'll show you again here in a moment. You can either buy the cash version of this mission, which costs 3,000 VP, which is the equivalent of $3, which allows you to almost immediately get the class, pretty much. Or you can choose to do the GP one, which will give you more experience with the game, help you level up, and just kind of give you a better idea of how this game plays. Which, especially if it's your first time getting your second job, you definitely want to grab this. But every now and then, Grand Chase will actually run speed run missions for or speed leveling events that will allow you to get all the cash versions of these quests for second job, third job, fourth bar ability, etc., completely for free. So kudos to them for that. I believe they've already ran it twice in the past 6 months, which is super cool, and I imagine they'll run it again. But for now, we're just going to go ahead and collect this GP mission here. The way that you'll do it is you go to your inventory, to the etc. page, you make sure you equip it, and it's only a few missions long. We go ahead and we go here. It wants you to clear the Whispering Woods one time. So it looks like they've changed this, actually, since I've last done this. But once we get there, it'll be after Forgotten City, Gaikaz's Castle. It'll be the very next dungeon after that. Another cool thing is Grand Chase actually gives you pretty much your entire first pet for free. And I don't just mean that in the sense of you don't have to pay for it. I mean they make it super easy to get them. As in, they give you the pet manual, which is supposed to be a random drop and could be a rare drop, and make it a guaranteed drop. So after doing your first Gaikaz's Castle run, you actually get the Gaikaz's pet manual. Which by now you may already have enough gate ore to craft it, and if not, there's another quest that appears in Gaikaz's Castle that actually gives you the gate ore directly to be able to craft the pet. And that's what I mean by a free pet. None of the grind, none of the effort, just right off the rip, you get your pet. Upon obtaining all resources needed to actually craft your Gaikaz's pet, this refinery here will glow red, and you'll kind of go over to the etc. tab, which is where you have your Squire Gaikaz card. It only takes 3 gate ore, which is why I was saying you might most likely have the gate ore already from doing your missions, and then your 1 out of 1 pet manual. So you just go ahead and click the forge button, and you have your pet. You go to your inventory, you go to your pet tab, and you can go ahead and right click your pet, and then he'll go ahead and insult you. What? This noob knight is my master. Just because, you know, he's the beginning pet, bullying you for being a noob. You can go ahead and costumes later in this game for your pets, you can get glyphs, and some pets even have alternate attacks, although Gaikaz, being the beginner pet, doesn't actually have any. The way that pet attacks work is if you look at the left-hand bar, there is a glowing blue and purple bar. Once that bar fills up, like it is now, towards glowing and flashing, that means that your pet attack is ready. So all you have to do is you have to aim the direction that you want to attack, so just look at the enemy, and you hit the shift key. That will cause your pet to use whatever their pet attack does. Pet attacks can not only deal damage to your enemies or opponents, but they can also do things like stun them, CC them, or crowd control them, whether it be knocking them down, slow them, just whatever it may be. It can also help to regenerate MP. So just like your normal attacks, when you have a bunch of enemies lined up over top of each other, your pet attack will also hit all those enemies at once. I'll demonstrate it here in just a second whenever it charges up again. Your pet attack charge meter does actually empty out whenever you enter into a new room, but I'll show you. You get more MP and you deal more damage if there's more enemies grouped up. Gaikaz, being the starter pet, again, doesn't do a lot of damage or give you a lot of MP gain, but it's definitely 1,000 times better than having no pet. Plus, he's super cute. I mean, look at that face. Now, once you get this far in the game, you might be running low on inventory space. If you were paying attention earlier, when these quests came up, which it's okay if you weren't, there's a mission for selling 10 items. So, since we're getting low on inventory space, we're going to go ahead and just sell 10 of these. Since none of these are useful anymore, we're just going to go ahead and sell. I typically don't like to sell items in this game, so I'm going to sell those 10. And we're going to go ahead and claim the mission reward here. Now, the way that I recommend handling this is actually go ahead and skip these quests for now for a little bit, because none of these are going to be super, super important unless you really want that red Gorgos egg for a pet. But you can go ahead and skip these, but if you want the red Gorgos egg desperately and you kind of want to keep going through these quests, If you want to know how that you're actually able to get this Red Gorgos egg right now, or rather, be able to get it soon, because you still need more level ups and stuff, I will show you how to do the upgrade item portion, which requires you to go over to the refinery here. You go to the reinforcement tab, and you click anything that you want to reinforce. If you're going to reinforce something, I highly recommend it be a weapon, preferably your equipped one, because that'll be your strongest. You'll kind of go ahead and you'll click on one of these reinforcement stones you should have, you'll equip it, and then you'll have the option to upgrade. And it does cost money and all that, but I don't want to bother wasting a reinforcement stone here, so I'm not going to go ahead and do that right now. Our next mission, though, it looks like, for our second job, is we have to go and defeat 8 or more firecrawlers in the ruins of the Silver Knight. So if I'm correct, that should be about 2 runs over here. So I'm going to go ahead and get those out of the way. Now if you finish your 2 runs of Ruins of the Silver Knight, you should have this mission completed, and that means that we're moved on to mission part 3, which is to defeat the Krakos in Lake Aurora and collect 3 Spearman Spirit Orbs. Or if you're playing a different character, it'll be a different type of Spirit Orb, but it'll be the same quest type. That is basically just requesting that you beat the final boss of Lake Aurora. By now, again, your inventory should be near full again, but I'll show you what I normally do when my inventory is full, as opposed to the method of selling items. What I like to do, because you can actually use these resources for other things, because these, one, don't really sell for much, and two, you can use these to craft cool armors later on and just use them as QWERTY, or maybe you might even have enough stuff to scrap that you can actually make armor right now. But you can go ahead and use crap all this stuff that, you know, you're high enough level to be able to use, and that'll give you different resources. The way you do that is you left click it, and it'll show up on the left side here, and then you can click dismantle. And you kind of go over to the forge here, and you can see now that you have materials to be able to equip, to craft your weapons and stuff. Now, it seemed that they actually, for Warrior Saint stuff, made it to where you don't actually require any of the Maybe it's for this. Okay, yep. So for the Victor stuff, it does cost the crystals, but they made it to where Warrior Saint stuff doesn't. It just costs your precious pearls and your dust. But if you want to craft these are some of the best. Well, anything that's in the equipment crafting tab is always the best gear of that level. So, like, this stuff here is the best level 24 gear. This is the best level 39 gear, which is the Victor's. This is the best 40 gear, which is the Warrior Spirit. 54. 63, you get the idea, but it keeps going. And these are your craftable armors and stuff that you use to craft from stuff that you took apart yourself. You can also craft accessories and stuff, which I don't really do any of this stuff really, but if you find yourself struggling, I highly recommend crafting whatever the highest level gear you can is. Just make sure that it fits your stuff, and every now and then as you're playing, you're also going to be able to get, you're also meeting map fragments. If you get one piece of each of the 4 different map fragment pieces, you can actually use it to craft 3 hero bullions. Now, that's not super important until late game, but it still helps you, because this game basically allows you to work towards late game gear, technically, without actually doing late game stuff. So you could be leveling up other characters, leveling up your main character, you know, just playing dungeons for the sake of playing dungeons, helping a friend, playing with a friend, and you're still getting heroes bullions, which is super important to late game. And I'll explain more to that later or in a future video. Upon reaching level 20, you will notice that, and I am a little late on this, that you do actually get the choice between a first draw weapon or a second draw weapon. And this will happen again when you reach the level and the capability to do third job stuff. But I want to mention it now because you might actually be claiming second job weapons, or if you haven't played the game yet, you want to just make sure you choose your first job. It is automatically selected, but I also want to show you something else. In case those of you guys who are watching the stream, or sorry, watching this video, haven't noticed, you do have potions. My potions have been going down, and those of you guys that are playing the game, you'll notice that you're going down on potions as well. You can buy more potions here at the shop. You did. Oh, click the wrong thing. You just want to go to shop, GP shop, consumes, and then recovery, or you can just kind of sit here, and you can buy as many in bulk as you want. I'm just going to buy 10. It's 10,000 GP. I have another 200,000 remaining. Here we are, we're finally on our final quest for unlocking second job, where we'll get the Quarity, we'll get 10 increased backpack space, a day of the Grand Chase Necklace, as well as the Training Spear, which is just a level 20 version of the second job weapon. All it wants us to do is kill 100 monsters within plus or minus 2 levels. So what we're going to do here is we're going up. So this guy doesn't have unlocked, but we'll play with him and we'll unlock it with him because we're feeling nice. But we're 29. That means enemies that we fight have to be between 27 and 31. And engine level is 28 to 30. So just keep fighting enemies where the majority of enemies, if not all enemies, are within plus or minus 2 levels of you. So even if we level up here, which we are about to, it'll be 30, which the dungeon is 28 to 30. So that'll still be having all enemies within range of our level. And here we are in those final moments where we get to claim our Spearman mission finale, getting our second job finally, or whichever class that you guys chose to play as or character. It gives you bonus stats, attack, defense, vitality. For getting class up, you get the nice necklace, and then you get the Quarity set. This one, the last one lasts you, I believe it was 7 days. But this one that you get, it does only last you 4 days, so we still will have 3 days after this runs out. But this one shows that we actually got further in the game than if we were wearing this. But if you like the vibe of this one more, obviously you can still wear it. Although it doesn't come with the gloves piece, so you're still wearing the Spearman gloves, but entirely up to you. Next class, if I am correct, is available at 40. Yep. Third job is available at 40, fourth job is available at 60, and like I promised earlier, if we go to the hero collection, we now have this portion here, the Spearman. So your first one's free basically for every single character, because you automatically have that class unlocked upon the creation of the character. Second job is obtained at 20, you can start the quest at 20 rather. Third job you can start at 40, and fourth job you can start at 60. So if you were to ever run Burkus's Lair, which is endgame content for this game, or close to endgame content for this game, her spearman class is an ability that is actually really good. And honestly, really high power Elysis, it's probably one of the two fastest clears in all of Grand Chase characters. So, we're just kind of doing a little bit of dungeon here. We're not going to do the whole dungeon, but just going to do a little bit of it, just to kind of show you guys what the gameplay kind of looks like for the Spearman. It's a very fast-hitting class. The problem is she lacks mobility, so like she doesn't have a sprint anymore. In the very beginning of this beginner's introduction, I mentioned that like you can sprint with Elysis first job, but this you kind of just have a hop. But this D ability, or this third bar, is what's so good against that final boss, but it just kind of drives right through them. But regardless, I do appreciate you guys so much for watching this video. It has been dragged on for a bit. Not necessarily dragged on, but the video has lasted for a while, and I would continue to go in to get a third job and some extra content there. But I'm going to save that for a mid-game video in Grand Chase that will go over hero dungeons and all that. So make sure you guys hit that like button, hit that subscribe button if you want to see more content like this or other content I may produce for more veteran players, or just showing off my own gameplay on my main account. But regardless, again, thank you guys so much for watching, and I will see you guys next time.